heart tonight. I thank you and I praise you for each and every soul that's here tonight. I thank you and I praise you because you have a message for each one of us tonight, O Lord. I pray right now that by your Holy Spirit fire, remove any sorrow, any sadness, anything that is distracting us from receiving this message from you, O Lord. Remove it by fire now, O Lord. Open up all our eyes, open up all our ears, and open up our hearts to receive your truth and to receive your love, O Lord. We condemn and we destroy anything, any power, any authority that stands in the way of you coming down and us receiving you, O Lord. Yes. We destroy it by the fire of Christ, O Lord. We thank you and we praise you for... We thank you and we praise you for already having done what you say you're going to do. Oh Lord, we thank you and we praise you even now, before, because we know that surely your words are true and you are not a liar. Oh Lord, I pray a special prayer on my sister Crystal, oh Lord. I pray that you would touch her. I pray that you would speak to her. I pray, oh Lord, that she would be lifted up to your upper room and lay her on your bed, oh Lord, and breathe life into her soul through this message, oh Lord. I thank you and I praise you for all my brothers and sisters. May you do miracles today, tomorrow, and forever. Big miracles and small miracles. In your mighty name we pray. Amen. We are going to be reading from 1 Kings chapter 17. We're going to focus in on the beginning of Elijah's life. So, to give you some background, before chapter 17 in Kings, Ahab is the king and the country is divided. It's a horrible time to be alive. They have turned against the Lord, they're worshiping idol gods, they have completely... It was the worst king, it was the worst time. It was very, very dark, very, very horrible place to be. And this is when Elijah appears. He appears. Just like the way he went, it's kind of the same way that he comes into the scriptures. If we begin with chapter 17, it goes, "And Elijah, the Tishbite of the inhabitants of Gilead." That's all that's said about him. It doesn't say, okay, his mother's name was this, he came from this line, he came from that line. You know how a lot of times they go through in great detail, who are you? Where do you come from? Who is your mom? Who is your dad? Where's your, you know, all we learn about, okay, he's this guy comes, right? This guy called Elijah. And what this is the first thing that he does. He says, he said to Ahab, wait a minute, Ahab is the king. He's speaking to the king. This nobody is speaking to the king. And what he's saying isn't something that the king would gladly receive. He said, "Ask the Lord of God of Israel lives, before whom I stand. There shall be no dew nor rain these years, except at my word." We all know the rest of the scriptures, but let's focus on just that. It doesn't say that the Lord spoke to Elijah to go to Ahab and tell him these words. No! It just says that Elijah showed up and he's so angry that he tells Ahab, there's going to be no rain, there's going to be no dew unless I say so. Wow. Have you ever been that angry that you've spoken some things that maybe once you calmed down, you thought, maybe I shouldn't have said those things? Yeah. We've all done that. And I feel that, can you imagine and put yourself in Elijah's position where he's so angry with the righteous anger, with the holy anger, because the people are doing horrible things to his God that he serves. And so he steps into the palace, goes in front of the king, knowing full well that he could be killed, and says, there's going to be no rain and no dew until I say so. And then he probably heard himself say it, and he goes, oh wow, I'm here in this palace, I've just said some pretty horrible things. Lord, protect me. And so it goes.
Send a chariot of fire now. Send that motorcycle right now.
That's right, no. So Elijah was very bold, but he was also a little bit what the world would call maybe foolish, maybe stupid, maybe, you know, doesn't think before he speaks. You know, we all know people like that, that like just blurt out things and then, oh wow, she really doesn't think before she speaks, or he doesn't think before he speaks, or he appears to be an airhead because he says this and this and that. I'm not calling Elijah an airhead, but I'm saying he was bold and he was so bold and so full of righteous anger that he couldn't help but not speak. Mm-hmm. He couldn't help but say something when he saw the whole world going down. He had to say something. Mm-hmm. And the interesting part is that in verse 2 it goes on and it says, then. So after he did this, the word of the Lord came to him. It didn't say that the word of the Lord came first. He spoke. Elijah spoke, and then the word of the Lord came to him saying, get away from here and turn eastward and hide by the brook which flows into the Jordan, and it will be that you shall drink from the brook, and I have commanded the ravens to feed you there. So, there's a curse on Israel. Elijah has cursed it. There's going to be no rain and there's going to be no dew. And God follows up and backs up that curse by sending away a prophet. So not only are you going to have no water and no dew, you're also not going to have the man of God. I'm going to send him away too. Say, go to the brook before the Jordan. Go to the brook before. Why you think if there's going to be a drought and no rain and no dew, and here's this man of God, why wouldn't you send him to a waterfall, a raging river where the brook is, it's not going to run dry. A brook is the smallest stream of water. That's defined. A brook you can step over, a creek you can jump over, and a stream you can wade through, and then a river you have to swim through, right? I thought that was interesting. So he sends him to a little brook. It's not a lot of water, but it's enough water for him at that time. And God says, I have commanded the ravens to bring you food. Well, ravens, they were unclean animals, right? Ravens were considered very unclean. And if you look up some facts on ravens, like I did, I found it very interesting. I didn't know all this about ravens, but they're also the most intelligent bird. And they're scavengers. They'll eat like roadkill. They steal food from other animals. They're really not very friendly animals, and they don't give away food. They actually take food from others to eat. They don't give away food. So God sends ravens. In Greek mythology, not that this has anything to do with Christianity, but I found it interesting. In Greek mythology, ravens are associated with Apollo, who is the god of prophets. I'm like, oh wow. So there is something about ravens. He didn't send them out, pretty little birds will, you know, drop flesh. No, ravens, the most unlikely bird, will bring you flesh. Bring you meat and you will eat it, and he will sustain you. He commanded the ravens. Remember that word. He commanded the ravens to bring them food, and they, and it goes on to prove that everything happened. So he went and did according to the word of the Lord. For he went and stayed by the brook Cherith, which flows into the Jordan. The ravens brought him bread and meat in the morning and bread and meat in the evening. So not just once a day, twice a day they came with food for him. And he drank from the brook. God's word came to pass immediately, and Elijah saw this. He saw it every day, twice a day. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. He didn't have to wait a day. He was fed that same day. Wow, what a faith booster. What a faith booster. You're at this brook. You have nothing. You don't even have to go hunt for food. You only have to just sit there and drink the water. And Lord, you said you would bring it, and he brings it not once a day, twice a day. Has God ever told you that he's going to bring you something and then he brings you double fun? You pray for fun, he brings you double fun. You pray for love, he brings you double love. You pray for $1, he gives you $2. He gives you more than enough, and he did that for Elijah here at the brook. But he wasn't meant to stay there forever. And so what happened? And it happened after a while that the brook dried up because there had been no rain in the land. Brooks usually dry up every summer. They're not, like I said, they're not usually constant pieces of running water. So this brook would have been one of the first ones to dry up, and it dried up. And so then you wonder, God, you said you would bring me meat. You said I could drink from the brook, and now you've dried up the brook. What am I supposed to drink? Most people start crying to God saying, you told me that you would feed me and that you would bring me water right here. You get mad because you get hungry and thirsty. be, and your emotions really stir up in you then, you know, when everything is going wrong at that time. I would get mad. But see, it was a temporary place. It was a temporary place for his faith to grow, for him to rely completely on God. It was a temporary place. Yet, when we are in our temporary place, we think it's permanent. Mm-hmm. We're in our temporary place and the brook is dry, but we expect to see water coming from it. Meanwhile, God is just waiting for you to turn around and ask him where to go next. Mm-hmm. Where do you go next? Stop hanging around by the brook that's not going to bring you water. Mm-hmm. Stop waiting for water that isn't going to come, because when there is no rain and when there is no dew, I don't care. It will dry up. It will dry up. So this is where Elisha finds himself, and now we get really into the meat of the story about the widow. Because as the brook dried up, in verse 8 it goes on, then the word of the Lord came to him saying, arise, go to Zarephath. Zarephath means smeltering shop. It's a place where metals are refined. It's a place where gold is refined, where silver is refined. It's a very hot place. Very hot, hotter than Phoenix in the summer. If you go to this place, expect to be refined, Jessica. Oh no, I don't want to go anymore. I'm fine the way I am. I don't want to be refined. Oh, but it belongs to...
Have you refined enough?
I'm okay, oh, it hurts. Which belongs to Sidon and dwells there. See, I have commanded a widow there. Huh, he's heard those words before. I have commanded the ravens to bring you food and bread. So he's seen that for a while. It said he stayed there, maybe years, maybe months, we don't know exactly how long. He's seen the God answer to fulfill his promise twice a day when he only expected once a day. And so when God then comes to him and says, you know, you believed me when I told you that the ravens would feed you. Now I can tell you who's really going to be feeding you. Because if we're not faithful with the small things, why is he going to bless you with the big things? Yep. And so we heard this. I have commanded a widow there to provide for you. Not just feed you. Some versions say sustain you. The ravens could only feed him and the brook could only give him water. What the widow can do for him is sustain him and provide for him, which means be there for him in emotional ways, in social ways, and in friendly ways. It means more than just having food. I have commanded her to provide for you. So he arose right away. He was obedient to God's word. The brook's already dry. I may as well take a chance. And if God says there's a widow in Zarephath waiting for me, who am I to wait around by the brook? When God tells you to leave something, to go to another place, you don't go and hang out and make camp by the dry brook and say, I was told to go here once, I have to stay here all my life. Mm-hmm. No, the brook was dry. He would have died there. But God did not want him to die. And so he asked him to move to Zarephath. And so he arose and went to Zarephath. And when he came to the gate of the city, so he didn't even have to go inside. Gate of the city. Indeed, a widow was there gathering sticks. It was a divine appointment because you see the needs of Elijah. He didn't have any food. He didn't have any water. He had just been walking about 75 miles to Zarephath. Can you imagine how thirsty he is? There's no rain. There's no water. There's no dew. He's probably super thirsty. And he doesn't even have to go into the city and go looking around and asking, you know, are you a widow? Are you a widow? Who's the widow, you know? No, he said, who has heard about me? No, she hadn't. Her spiritual ears hadn't been open for that command even. God had spoken to her in the spirit, not to her words in her ears. She didn't know what he knew about her. That's how amazing God is. So he comes to the gate, and he sees this woman who he knows is a widow, and she's gathering sticks. Gathering sticks. And he called to her and said, please bring me a little water in a cup that I may drink. Again, he was very thirsty. He had been walking 75 miles from the brook to Zarephath, and there was no water. And as he asked that, again, prophets sometimes speak before. They don't realize what they're saying because it's God speaking. And as she was going to get it, So he stopped her as she's on her way. Jessica, you asked me for a glass of water. Ask me.
Oh, sorry. No,
glass of water. Okay, I'll go get it. As I'm walking. Oh, wait, Sophia. Ask me for
a
glass
of food.
Okay, you want some food, but I thought you wanted water. So I found the question kind of a little rude. It's like, okay, she was on her way to fetch some water, and then it's like, oh, by the way, I need more from you. I need more than water from you. He called to her and said, please bring me a morsel of bread in my hand. And so she said, as the Lord your God lives, I do not have bread, only a handful of flour in a bin and a little oil in a jar. And see, I'm gathering a couple of sticks that I may go in and prepare it for myself and my son, that we may eat it and die. So she was outside of the city looking for sticks. During a drought, she had actually gone outside of the gate to look for dry sticks. I can imagine that mostly anything inside the city, it could be used as tinder for a fire when it hasn't rained in forever. You don't have to look very hard to look for sticks. What is she thinking about if she's out there looking for sticks? What is she praying for? She was led by the Spirit to the divine appointment, to two people that are so desperate, that need one another so desperately, because without one another, they both would have been dead. If they wouldn't have met, they both would have been dead. He would not have been fed, and she would have went home and made her food and died. Have you had a person like that in your life, that if you wouldn't have met them, you would be dead? Because two are better than one. And sometimes, sadly, you alone are not enough. We like to pretend to be strong and say, I can survive this, I'm fine, I don't need anybody, I'll be really strong. Yeah, it doesn't matter how strong you are, Elijah. If you stay by the brook, you're gonna die. It doesn't matter how stubborn you are, widow. If you don't share food with him, you'll do exactly what you already said you would do. You will eat some food and go home and die. It was a divine appointment, and they needed one another for such a time as this. And he had to give something up, and she had to give something up. And so they met, and she said, I don't have anything. And Elijah said to her, do not fear. That's the emotion that he chose to say. Do not fear. He doesn't say, do not be anxious, do not doubt. Do not fear. Because he sensed her spirit. She was about ready to die. She was fearful in her spirit. Go and do as I have said. And this is his command to her. But make me a small cake. Notice the small. We always see this request as being, oh wow, she had to feed Elijah before she fed her own son. Oh, how shameful, how can we ask? He's asking for a small bite. A small bite, a small cake from it first and bring it to me. And afterwards make some for yourself and your son. He's not saying, give me all of it. He's not saying, give me most of it. Just give me a little piece, just a crumb. It doesn't take much to be obedient to the Lord and the things we're asked to give him. Just give him a little. Give him a little and he wants to give you a lot. Just give me a little and you have more. You don't have to give me everything. Just give me a little, give me some. It's the act of obeying me and trusting him and not fearing him and just doing it anyways, even though it makes no physical sense. If you have $100 in your bank account and somebody asks you for some, usually we say, well, I only have 100 bucks, so I don't have anything to give. Well, you only have 100, so why don't you just give him $25? What's really the big difference between $75 and $100? It's a big difference in God's kingdom. Those $25 can be multiplied. I'm not preaching or saying that that happens. I'm saying if you are called to give out of your little bank account to a man of God or to a woman of God that is in need of a little. If you keep it all to yourself, you shall surely die and run dry. But if you give just a little, listen to the promise. Listen to the promise. For thus says the Lord of Israel, the bin of flour shall not be used up, nor shall the jar of oil run dry, until the day of the Lord sends rain on the earth. Elijah had just walked into Ahab's palace and with righteous anger told him, there's not going to be any rain or any dew until I say so. And he probably walked out and said, oh, wow, that's crazy. It's not raining anymore. Can you imagine? Like, this is the first thing that Elijah said. Do you think that maybe at some times he was like, wow, Lord, you didn't even tell me to say that, and you still fulfilled my word? That is the power that Oleg was talking about. We have the power to make things happen. Good things. Things of the Spirit. See, God doesn't always have to say it, blah, 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 say it exactly like that. He is in your spirit. If you yield yourself in the Spirit, if you give everything up, you're already there. So you don't need the instruction. So how come he can tell this poor widowed woman who has suffered death? Her husband has died. She's emotionally dead, right? She is physically dead, basically saying, I'm just going to have one more meal and then I'm going to die. She's spiritually dead because she doesn't believe what's coming to her. She's dead. She was dead. And so Elijah spoke this command, this promise to her, knowing that the same God that answered his word, that fulfilled the things that he said to Ahab, surely, if he can make it not rain or have any dew in the whole country, surely he can provide for this poor widow. No problem.
That's
no
amazing.
Problem.
Yeah, that's amazing on the liberty that the Lord has really given those that are in Christ. I mean, the New Testament talks about that liberty. Mm-hmm. And I wonder how many people exercise that liberty. And I think one of the things that you said was that you said that Elijah had righteous anger against what was going on. Ahab was one of the most evil kings. Mm-hmm. And Elijah had righteous anger. Mm-hmm. And I don't, whatever Elijah would have said, the Lord would have honored.
Mm-hmm. Anything.
Even something as ridiculous. No rain at my word. It's just amazing. That kind of liberty that the Lord gives us is just amazing.
Mm-hmm.
It's amazing.
Yes.
But go ahead. I'm sorry. That just caught me there. That, wow, look at the liberty mm-hmm. that the
and
Lord
gave.
And
we don't use that power because we don't believe it for us. Brad, you're no different than Elijah. Mm-hmm. You're no different. You're a man.
Yeah.
Elijah was a man. Still you're no Elijah. Different. You have the Spirit. He had the Spirit. That's really all it is.
Hmm.
You were born and you have received God. You're no different. But yet, we look at Elijah and say, oh, wow. Yeah, it even says in James that he was a man that had with similar passions. He struggled with the same things. He was not a perfect person. He was not Jesus Christ. He had sin. He had doubt. He had fear. He wanted to kill himself at one point. But that's after the story. And so, this is the promise that was spoken through Elijah's mouth to the widow. And she probably felt it in her spirit and said, okay, this man is very passionate. I'm just going to give him some and I'm going to die anyways. I don't believe that she knew everything that he said to be true. In fact, I know that she had doubt because the scripture proves it later. She had doubt. She didn't hear these words and was like, oh, right, my oil is never going to run dry. Jessica, my flowers never going to go away. Woo, yeah. You know what? If that was her spirit, she would have given him a lot. She would have given him all of it. If she knew that she was never going to run dry. No, the power of her obedience wasn't in believing it all like this. It was doing this. I'll do one step. You take one step. I'll do one step. I'll take one step. It's not that this woman didn't doubt. It's not that she didn't fear anymore after he said, do not fear. No, she did. But she knew what was more important than focusing on those things. You just have to take one step. He only asked for a little. I'll give him a little. We'll see what happens. We'll see what happens. And so she went away and did according to the word of Elijah. And she and he and her household ate for many days. Some people believe many days is a year. So it was a long time. They feasted for many days. And the bin of flour was never used up. Nor did the jar of oil run dry, according to the word of the Lord, which he spoke by Elijah. The word was spoken by Elijah's voice, and God backed him up because he knew his spirit. Because God had commanded him to go, and he had already spoken it. This widow will provide for you. Well, had he not given the blessing of God on her, he would have held God back. his destiny, from the plan that he already had. See, when we hear a word from God say, go to Zarephath, I've commanded a widow there to provide for you. Oh, wow, this widow must be super rich and have lots of food and blah, blah, blah. No, it's the same thing as the brook. The widow is the brook. The widow is the brook. The brook was the smallest of all streams of living water. The widow would be the last person you send somebody to provide for another person. The last person. But it's the first person that God thinks of, because the last shall be first and the first shall be last. He uses those that seem unusable.
Yep.
Yeah.
Unusable. Yes. He wants to use you and I. And we think we're unusable, and we let the world speak to us and say, well, I don't have this education, I don't have this, I do this wrong, da 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 da. We're very quick to judge ourselves and to see the imperfections, when God has made you beautiful and perfect, just the way you are. Yes, we have struggles. Yes, we have fears. Yes, we have sin. But forget about it. Leave that behind you. Just take baby steps. Everything's forgiven. Forget about it. Don't focus on yesterday when there's tomorrow. Don't focus on last hour when you have the next hour.
That's right.
We need to forget all the junk. We need to leave it behind and forget who Satan wants to define us as, and focus on what God says about us. When you look yourself in the mirror, what do you say? Do you focus on everything you want to see changed? Or do you focus on looking into your own eyes and saying and knowing that, wow, God, I didn't do this. You made this. You made me. Why? What do you want me to do? Where do you want me to go? And who do you want me to provide for?
Wow.
And that's the main story of the widow's provision. But
it's terrifying to see if this widow had not been obedient. What would have happened? I mean, this would have been a different story.
They both would have died.
Had this widow not been obedient, can you imagine what this story would have been like? He probably wouldn't have made it in the Bible.
No, because they would have died.
Yeah.
I believe that they would have died. There are such strong commands from the Lord on your life that sometimes leave you no choice but to obey.
Yep.
Oh, yeah.
No choice but to obey, because He shows you what will happen. He shows you what will happen if you disobey. God showed up one day and said, if you don't do this, Sophia, you will never have another chance ever again, and you'll be stuck for life, and this is what you're going to be thinking when you die. I said, wow, that's crazy. So if I don't do this now, in this very hour, this very time, I will have no other chances, and nothing will ever change, and I will probably end up living a very long life, unhappy life, and die with regret, saying, what if I would have? What if I would have gone to Zarephath? What if I would have gone to the smeltering pot to be refined?
Yep.
What if I would have gone? I said, I don't care how hot it is. I don't want to die with regret. Yep. I don't care how hot it is. I don't care how much it burns. I don't care. I don't care. I'm just going to go and do as you say. And it was like this. Baby steps. Baby steps. Baby steps. Yeah. Baby steps. It's too good. See, the widow, I don't believe, and this is my own interpretation through reading the scripture over and over again, I don't think that God immediately filled the jar up to the rim, you know, or filled the bottle of oil up to the rim. Oh, look, we have so much. Look, we have so much, you know, we have so much. No, I believe he did the same thing that he did with the ravens. Just enough for the day.
Yep.
Just enough manna for the day. Are you going to believe me today and tomorrow and the next day for a year? Can you imagine all the thoughts going through? She already struggles with fear. Can you imagine fear? What if tomorrow morning his words aren't true? What if tomorrow morning? What if tomorrow morning? And scripture will prove it, that that was what happened, as we go on to read now about the widow's son. Now it happened after these things that the son of the woman who owned the house became sick. So not only was she cooking for Elijah and bringing him water and supporting him and providing him, she was also housing him. He had a room, an upper room, it said. He was living with a widow. Now I don't know how frowned upon that was in those days. I didn't do any research on that. But even today, that would be kind of frowned upon. A man shouldn't live with a widowed woman because we want to stay away from temptation, la 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 la.
He was just a roommate.
He was in his own bedroom.
Yes.
Yeah. Anyways, that's a different story for a different day. But his sickness was so serious that there was no breath left in him. So this son had died. There was no breath left in him. And what does the woman do? So she said to Elijah, "What have I to do with you, O man of God?" Wow. Wow. So this is the same man that spoke the promise and that his prayers have been feeding her for a year, and her true feelings come out in adversity, right? When the pressure is turned up for her, her true emotions come out. "What have I to do with you, O man of God? Have you come to bring my sin to remembrance and to kill my son?" My sin to remembrance. Can you imagine if they've been together, living together in the same house for a year? A prophet of God. Obviously, they've talked about God. Obviously, he had been teaching her about sin. This was not a city in Israel. This was outside. This was a Gentile nation. She didn't know the God of gods. She didn't know the King of kings. But her faith had been being restored through the prophet Elijah, and now she has become a new woman. And now her son died, and she says, "And now you're remembering the sins of my past, back when I lived in the Gentile city, back when I did those horrible things, back when I feared, back when I didn't trust. You're bringing all that stuff up. Now, when bad things happen to us, isn't that what we think too?" God, I prayed about this. I pray for my son every day, and you are going to kill him now? We get mad. Just like she got mad at Elijah, we get mad at God when these things happen. And we even get mad at people that have prayed for us sometimes. Because we hear the words and we doubt them, and okay, well, Jessica prayed this prayer over me and it didn't happen, so I'm not going to ask her to pray anymore. Because that obviously didn't happen. No, that's not how God works. That's not how God works at all. And he said to her, "Give me your son." And the next says, so he took him out of her arms. She was so mad she wouldn't even give her own son to him. She was holding him, and he said, "Give me your son." Did she give him? No, he had to take him out of her arms. She was so mad at him. This boy was already dead, and she's holding on to him because she loves him. She misses him. She wants him to come back. She said, "Don't even touch him." But so he yanked him out of her arms and carried him to the upper room. Many things happen in upper rooms. Miracles, mighty miracles happen in upper rooms. See, God has these places in the world that are holy ground. He has these certain spots. We know when we're in those places because you feel the presence of the Lord. Sometimes it's inside, sometimes it's outside, sometimes it's upstairs, sometimes it's downstairs. I know that God has a place for each of you. You may not know the place, but there is not a prophet or a son of God that has not been given a place here in the world to be with him. Have you found your place yet? Have you found your upper room? Do you know where God comes down? In the upper room. If you haven't found your upper room, go find it.
And it's proving, these words that you were saying are proving, even from what you discovered happened to Abraham, Jacob, Isaac, everywhere that they met with God, they built an altar. Mm-hmm. That altar place is also known as the upper room for them. So they built an altar there saying, "I met God over here."
Mm-hmm. Even and when Jacob had the dream.
Exactly.
The stone. Jacob,
yeah. So it's kind of like an upper room, a holy ground, so to speak. So absolutely, that's true. Yes.
Mm-hmm. And he laid him on his own bed, his anointed bed, the bed where God speaks to him. And then he cried out to the Lord and said, "Oh my God, you have also brought tragedy on the widow with whom I lodge." Wow, wait a minute, stop there. Oh Lord my God, have you also brought tragedy? Wait, what is he talking, what is the also? See, I don't think that the tragedy that he's talking about, that he's saying also, is the drought that he brought. I think he was talking about himself. This is a private prayer, a personal prayer. We know that Elijah struggled with depression. We know that Elijah struggled with loneliness. Have you also brought trouble on her? Sometimes the things that hurt are the ones that we love. That hurts more than us being hurt. We wish for those things to happen to us because I'd rather see myself suffer than see my beloved suffer. We don't want to see the ones that we love suffer. We'd rather take the knife ourselves. And he cried out to the Lord by killing her son. So he stretched himself out on the child 3 times and cried out to the Lord and said, "Oh Lord my God, I pray, let this child's soul come back to him." Bold prayer. Bold moves. Bold prayers with bold moves. He didn't just pray. He threw himself on a little boy. We don't know how big he, maybe Elijah was really fat. I don't know. You're even going to crush this little boy. He just threw himself on top of him, not once, not twice, 3 times. Bold moves go along with bold prayers. God wants us to act and react. Then the Lord heard the voice of Elijah. It doesn't say he heard Elijah. He heard the voice of Elijah. And the voice of Elijah has been used as God's voice. He had a blessed voice. And the soul of the child came back to him and he revived. And Elijah took the child and brought him down from the upper room into the house and gave him to his mother. And Elijah said, "See, your son lives." Then the woman said to Elijah, "Now by this I know that you are a man of God and that the word of the Lord is in your mouth is true. Now I know." This lady has been seeing miracle after miracle after miracle after miracle for up to a year. She was being fed when she had nothing. She had nothing. She had only a handful of flour and her whole household was fed for a year. And she didn't believe that he was truly a man of God and that what he was saying was true. See, God does those daily miracles in our lives every day. Every day he gives us flour. Every day he gives us oil. But we don't give him credit for it. And we don't believe him because when it comes down to it, when we need him for the bigger things, we forget everything he's already done. I've fed you for a year. And so some of us, shame on us if we are going to wait for the mighty miracle to say, "This is a man of God. These words are true." God forbid that we stop God's miracles every day and we don't give him credit. We don't thank him. In fact, we accuse him when something bad happens. I'm not trashing the widow. She obeyed. That's all she had to do. I'm saying we are like her. We are like her. We have been sent to help those that have been sent to us, to provide for them. I don't like it when pastors preach this message and say that in the same way that the widow gave a little bit to Elijah, we also need to give a little bit to the church. I don't see it as that. I see it as God sent him, her, a man, someone in the flesh, to you, who asked you for something. Aren't we approached by people like that all the time? Are you aware in your spirit who's truly sent from God and who's truly not? Because not everybody is. You're not. You can't help everybody.
Can I share a testimony on that?
Yes.
We were I went to Safeway in our neighborhood. And I passed by a guy, and hello, so came back, passed by the same guy again. The guy, I mean, he had, I didn't know he was a beggar. He didn't ask for money. He just had his bags there as if, he had his bags there as if he had done some shopping at Safeway and he was waiting. I thought he was waiting for a ride. That's what I actually thought. So, passed by again. The guy said, "God be with you." Nobody prays for you, Christy. You don't pass by a stranger and the stranger prays for you. How did this happen? That was one of the things that I felt, whoa, wow, this is not a normal situation here. This is something that is maybe this is someone that God has planted over here. Okay. And so, as I went back and asked, hey, is there anything, is everything okay, sir? Anything I can pray for? Oh, no, he says, everything is okay. I said, well, let's hear a prayer anyway. And I remember praying for the guy, and I left the place in tears. There was nothing that I could do for him. There was much that he did for me. Mm. There's nothing that he wanted from me, but there was much that he imparted. I asked what his name was. Guess what his name was? Joel. I said, wow, Prophet Joel. I said, Prophet Joel. I said, wow, very interesting. So you just never know as we go by each day. You just never know. But I found it strange that a man would just say, God be with you when you pass it. People don't bless you, you know. People don't do that. But go ahead.
But what we want to get out of this tonight is, let's do what the widow did. When you're asked to do what looks and appears to be impossible, if God is asking you, do it anyways. Even if you fear, even if you doubt, even if you think, I don't know, Lord, I don't know how you're going to do this, but I will do it anyways. Help me with my faith. Help me grow in my faith. Help me not to fear as I do this. Help me not to worry about what I'm giving up. And help me to praise you for what you're about to give me. Oh, Lord, I don't know what that is. I don't care what it is, but I know that when I do what you've asked me to do that seems impossible and crazy, I mean, some people were probably judging her for giving a stranger food before feeding her own child. They were about to die. Can you imagine if some mother did that now? And she would probably have her child taken from her to custody, because you can't, that would be child abuse. You can't give a homeless person all your money and all your food, and you go home, I don't have any food to feed my child. Now we're going to die sooner. No, she did a crazy thing. She did something that people would not do, because she didn't know him. She'd never seen him before. She didn't know the power that was in him. She was asked to do the impossible, and you know what? She said, I'm dead anyways. I'm dead anyways. I have nothing left to live for. I have no husband. I have no food. I have no water. I have so much fear. I am dead anyways. My friends, you're all dead anyways too. I'm sorry. You are all dead anyways. So don't hold on to anything in this world. You're dead anyways. I'm dead anyways. Do it. See what God will do. You want to see miracles in your life? Then forget about reasoning. Forget about rationality. I'm not saying go be stupid. I'm saying go be spiritual. Go and ask the Lord. What is your purpose? Where is he sending you? And to whom is he sending you to? And who are you to help and provide for? And give the first little cake to. Let's pray. Dear Heavenly Father, I thank you and I praise you for the mighty words that you've spoken tonight. I thank you and I praise you for the deliverance of truth. Oh Lord, I thank you and I praise you that tonight you have shown us that we are called to do greater things than where we are now, oh Lord. I pray that in the spirit right now that you would dry up every brook that might be feeding us, oh Lord, and kill every raven that is bringing us food, and take us into our promised land, oh Lord. Take us all into the smeltering pot, oh Lord. Take us to those that we belong to, oh Lord. Those that have been sent to help us, oh Lord. Those that have been sent to love us, oh Lord. Take us away from the brook. Anything that is tempting us to stay in a temporary situation, oh Lord, kill it now. Oh Lord, with my mouth I will say the same thing that Elijah said, oh Lord. Let there be no rain or no dew on those brooks right now, oh Lord. They will not provide any more nourishment for us, because we're not meant to stay there, Lord. We're not meant to stay there. You have greater plans for us. Not because we're great, not because we never do wrong, but because you made us perfect, oh Lord. You made us perfect, oh Lord. We are only vessels to be used on earth here, O Lord. Use us now, O Lord. Do something wonderful. Do something miraculous. Do something glorious with each and every life here, O Lord. I pray that they would find their widow. I pray that they would find their Elijah, O Lord. I pray that they would find the one that they cannot live without. Oh Lord, I pray that you would find the one that they cannot live without, that if they don't meet them, they will die. Oh Lord, let everybody here tonight meet that person. Oh Lord, I pray and I prophesy many miracles and many testimonies, oh Lord, daily miracles, oh Lord. Forgive us for not giving you praise for the miracle that we woke up this morning, oh Lord, that we got to breathe, oh Lord, that we didn't have to go to the hospital, that we were blessed to help others, oh Lord. I thank you and I praise you for the oil never running dry and the flour never going away, oh Lord. I prophesy in the same way that Elijah did, that our flour will never run dry and our oil will never run out, oh Lord. Together, it will always be provided for. We will always be provided for and sustained and loved, oh Lord. I thank you and I praise you for the mighty power that you've given each one of us. The power to speak your words, oh Lord. Let it be used for your glory and for your good and for your miracles, oh Lord. I thank you and I praise you that Elijah was just like us. Oh Lord, there is nothing different. He was a man. We are men and women. He was had similar passions, oh Lord. He had similar struggles, oh Lord. Let the same glory come over us now, oh Lord. Let us raise people from the dead and breathe life into dead souls, oh Lord. Any soul here that is dead tonight, oh Lord, we breathe life on that soul right now. Come up in the upper room, oh Lord, and lock, oh Lord, I'm not going to throw myself on top of anybody, but you throw yourself on them now. Yeah. Multiple times, throw yourself over them. Bang them with your body, oh Lord, so that they may know that you are God. Yes. Oh Lord, I thank you and I praise you. May we be safe this next week as we go our separate ways. And may you speak even more mightily in the day.